take your Bibles and let's go to work. Let's go to the book of Acts. Acts chapter 3. And I want to begin reading verses 1 through 10. Acts chapter 3, verses 1 through 10. The word of God says, "Now Peter and John went up together into the temple at the hour of prayer, being the ninth hour. And a certain lame man from his mother's womb was carried, whom they laid daily at the gate of the temple, which is called Beautiful, to ask alms of them that entered into the temple." Verse number 3, "Who seeing Peter and John about to go into the temple, asked in alms. And Peter, fastening his eyes upon him with John, said, 'Look on us.' And he gave heed unto them, expecting to receive something of them. Then Peter said, 'Silver and gold have I none, but such as I have, give I thee. In the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, rise up and walk.' And he took him by the right hand and lifted him up, and immediately his feet and ankle bones received strength." Verse 8, "And he, leaping up, stood and walked and entered with them into the temple, walking and leaping and praising God. And all the people saw him walking and praising God." Verse number 10, "And they knew that it was he which sat for alms at the beautiful gate of the temple. And they were filled with wonder and amazement at that which had happened unto him." In harmony with our theme, again, we share with you on the subject, hope amidst the crisis. Let's talk with the Lord. Father God, we thank you right now. Though the devil would have thought he could have stopped camp meeting in the Central Jamaica Conference, he couldn't stop it. Although we're worshiping virtually, we still give you praise. We still give you honor. We still give you glory. And we believe that we still have hope amidst the crisis we're in. Now, God, speak through me as I speak to your people. May your Holy Ghost penetrate the airwaves and television and internet waves today. And may your people see Jesus and never be the same again. Forgive me of my sins, hide me behind your cross. It's in the name of Jesus we pray. Amen. Hope amidst the crisis. As of this week, there have been over 68 million cases of the coronavirus worldwide and 1.6 million deaths. In Jamaica, there have been 11,000 cases and over 260 deaths. In the United States, the most advanced nation in the world, as many say, there have been yet 15 million coronavirus cases and over 290,000 deaths and counting in the United States. We're in a crisis. But it's not just the coronavirus afflicting our world. It's also the hurricanes and tropical storms. And being there in Jamaica, an island nation, you know as well as I do that we've had more storms this Atlantic hurricane season than ever before. In fact, we've had so many storms this past year in this storm season that we exhausted alphabet letter name storms and had to use Greek alphabet letter name storms. We're in a crisis. But it's not just the coronavirus. It's not just hurricanes and tropical storms, but it's also been the economic challenges that still plague our society. There's a widening gap between the haves and the have-nots. Globally, less than 10% of the population of a population controls the wealth of our world, while the remaining 90% of the population in our world has little or no substantial net worth. And as long as the chief concern of the rich is not to share their bounty with the least of these, our society will remain divided with strife. As long as those with power are obsessed with staying in power rather than sharing their power and their influence with and for the good of other people, we're headed for a time of disaster. As long as the informed are purposeful in keeping many of the marginalized uninformed and misinformed, friends of mine, we are headed for implosion. We are in a crisis. Socially, we're also in trouble. Too many social ills in our society have gone unattended for so long. Systemic racism is still widespread. We still have a drug epidemic to root out, a crime wave to tame, a health crisis to manage, a homeless humanity to shelter, an illiterate environment to weed out, and a generation X, Y, and Z to reach. It's no secret that we're losing our children and our young people. Children are dying before they have a chance to live. Young people know how to fire a gun before they can walk and chew gum at the same time. We're in a crisis. But we also have spiritual troubles. That's right, we've got spiritual troubles. D. Elton Young Trueblood, in his book, The Predicament of Modern Man, said, "The biggest disappointment of our time is the fact that technological advances and scientific discoveries, as well as economic and political breakthroughs, have failed to make us a happier, healthy, and wholesome society." He says, technology has advanced, but morality has declined. Industry has skyrocketed, but ethics and moral values have nosedived. We have enjoyed a period of relative peace from military confrontation, but spiritual war has been engaged. Let me, if you will, double back to our young people for a few minutes. I'm concerned that in the church, we're not just seeing physical life lost among our young people, but spiritual life is also being lost among our young people. In this era of Zoom church, of StreamYard church, of video church, of virtual church, we're finding that our young people are not attending or watching church. Virtual programs are being planned, but they don't view. Virtual programs are being shown and church services produced, but they don't watch. We're in a crisis. But I've got some good news today, because despite physical challenges, despite economic challenges, despite environmental challenges, despite social challenges, despite spiritual challenges, I've got some good news today. We can still have hope amidst the crisis. And so to my Jamaican brothers and sisters, hold on, because hope is on the way. And we can have hope amidst the crisis because Jesus Christ, the hope of glory, is on the way. Now, before I get too excited about the fact that hope is on the way, let me tell you about a hope in the midst of a crisis. In our text, Acts chapter 3, we've read about Peter and John. And Peter and John are on their way to the temple. They're on their way to the church for a 3 o'clock prayer meeting in the afternoon. Now, somebody might be asking, Pastor Bird, 3 o'clock in the afternoon, but this was normal for them because biblical history suggests that devout Jews and Gentiles went to the temple 3 times a day to pray. They went at 9 a.m., 3 p.m., and 6 p.m. So understand, this was not strange for Peter and John. They went to church for prayer meeting because they knew that much prayer meant much power. I wish I had a witness with me today. Now, Peter and John are on their way to the temple, but as they're walking up to the temple, they get to the gate of the temple, which is called Beautiful. And they meet a man who's been lame from his birth, and he's begging for money. Now, be reminded, it's important to note that the man is not inside the temple, but the man is outside the temple begging for money at the gate. Every day, he's at the gate begging. In order to live, he has to beg. In order to eat, he has to beg. In order to live, he has to beg. In order to survive, he has to beg. He can't work. There are no social service institutions. There is no government social security. There is no public assistance. The man has to beg. And don't get it twisted, friends of mine. Let me throw this in. Even though we have social service institutions in our world today, whether it's the United Way, whether it's Goodwill, whether it's the Salvation Army, there are still some people in the 21st century who live in Jamaica, who live in the United States, that still have to beg. In fact, nearly one half of the world's population, that's 3 billion people, live on less than $2.50 US per day. And some people think that with all the government assistance we have today, with all the non-government assistance we have, whether it's nonprofits like churches or whatever they are, they think that with all this assistance to help the poor, there shouldn't be beggars on the street. Let me remind you, friends of mine, today that sometimes it's hard for people to get on their feet because we live in a society where the poor rich are getting richer and the poor are getting poorer. And just in case you didn't know, not all beggars are con artists. Not all beggars have suffered from drug abuse or alcohol abuse or own drugs or alcohol. Not all beggars are mentally disabled. There are some people who have genuinely just had a rough life. If you don't believe me, then miss your check 1 month. Miss your check 1 pay period and see what happens to you. Don't look down on other folk because somebody who's watching, you're 1 check away, 1 pay period away, 1 direct deposit away from bankruptcy or homelessness. And I believe I've got a witness that is watching right now that knows if it had not been for the Lord on my side, where would I be? But there is a flip side to this, because there are some people who don't want to do better for themselves. They like to talk about what they don't have instead of using what they do have. They rather wallow in the pits of discouragement and discomfort and despair by indulging in pity parties. Some people don't want the responsibility of what goes along with being blessed. Being sick or being broke gives them an excuse to lie on their backs and wait for somebody else to do it for them. The fact is, some people will go through extraordinary lengths to avoid doing something in their lives. They live, if you will, in the twilight zone of thinking that doing nothing will get them something. But because they do nothing, they're in the same place they've always been. Their minds are stagnant. They have no new ideas. Innovation is dead and buried. Creative thoughts don't stand a chance. Thinking outside the box never crosses their minds. They think things will never change. They think things will always be the same. They think things will never get better. So what do? They do what they've always done. And that, my friends, was the lame beggar. The lame man sat at the same place, begging for the same money every day. Every morning, the lame man waited for somebody to carry him to the gate. Every evening, the lame man waited for somebody to carry him home from the gates. And between morning and evening, he begged. But you know what? Let's give the beggar some credit. At least he was a smart beggar. At least he was a businessman. Why do I say that? He picked the most profitable place in Jerusalem to beg. Each day, he sat outside the temple gate to have the best chance to receive money from people entering the temple. After all, if anybody should have been concerned about the needs of people, it should be those people who were going to church. After all, church folk can't wait to get into the temple to pray, and they can't ignore the cries of those in need at the same time at the gate. But not only that, the people coming to this gate, I believe they had to be people of means. Why? Remember, the Bible says the gate was called Beautiful. Because it was decorated with Corinthian bronze, and when the sun rose, the sun cast its glorious glow on the gate. But now let's expand this concept of begging, because it's not just those outside the temple who were begging, but it's also those inside the temple who were begging. Because remember, begging is defined, or a beggar is defined, as one who comes to get something but gives nothing. And there are a lot of people who come inside the church and they want something, but they give nothing. They want something out of worship, but they don't want to give anything to worship. They want somebody to pray for them, but they don't want to pray for somebody else. They want people to sing the hymns, but they don't want to sing the hymns. They want a good sermon, but they don't want to encourage the preacher in the sermon. They're always ready to receive, but they're never ready to give. Peter and John walk up to the gates. The man is begging alms, 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 which meant money, money, money. Peter stops. Peter looks at the man. And then Peter says, look at us. Now, this is important. Peter's statement is important because it's in harmony with the actions of Jesus whenever Jesus healed somebody when Jesus was on this earth. Remember, when Jesus was on this earth, Jesus never walked up to somebody and simply touched them and healed them without first directing their attention to himself. Jesus always captured the attention of individuals. He wanted to heal them and directed them to focus their eyes upon him. And the reason he did this was because it stirred a sense of expectation in them. And this, my friends, is what happened here. The man, he thought he was just going to get some money from Peter and John, but his faith was quickened by Peter's words when Peter said, look at us. Because in order to receive something from God, you've got to first expect something from God. You don't hear what I'm saying. That's why even when I come to church, even without people, even to a church empty of people, even when I'm preaching to myself and the media team that's recording me, I need you to understand I'm expecting something. I'm looking for a miracle. I'm expecting the impossible, because without faith, it is impossible to please the Lord. There are some people who have gone to church for years. They've gone to church all of their lives, but their lives are no different from when they first started going to church, because they've never given their attention to God. They've never expected to receive anything when they came. When they came to church, when they got to service, they turned their minds off. They were looking at their phones. They're on social media. They take mental vacations. They're thinking about what they're going to eat after church is over. Life-changing truth passes them right on by, and that's why some people can sit in church for years and they can never be changed. There are some of our young people who've been raised in the church but show no evidence that God is at work in their lives, and that's because they've never heard the words from Jesus, look at us, and paid attention. This is why Jesus always said to the people when he preached, he who has ears, let him hear. But friends, when you follow the story, you notice that as soon as Peter tells the beggar to look at him, Peter has the man's attention and the man expects to receive something from Peter. Peter responds to the man's plea with two responses. First, Peter admits his own financial bankruptcy in the material realm, and he says, silver and gold have I none. In other words, we don't have what you want, but we do have what you need. Because there's a difference, my friends, between wants and needs. We have a lot of things, and we want a lot of things, but we only need some things. Somebody wants a Mercedes, but somebody really needs a Ford. Somebody wants some oxtails, but that somebody really just needs a salad. Somebody wants some curry goats, but that somebody just really needs some curry soy. Wants satisfy a desire, but needs satisfy a necessity. Peter said, look, we don't have anything in the material, but I do have something in the spiritual. If you're looking for money, I have none, but I've got something better. If you're looking for coins, I have none, but I have something better. If you're looking for dollar bills, I have none, but I have something better. Peter said, in the name of Jesus of Nazareth, rise up and walk. And in that miraculous moment, the Bible says this man is looking at Peter and John, and this man hears these words, and at the mention of the name of Jesus, something miraculous happens. Strength begins flowing in his ankles. Peter reaches out his hand. The man takes Peter's hand, and Peter lifts the man up. The man, the Bible says, rose up and began to leap. He began to shout. He began to jump. He began to praise God. Now, I've always asked myself when I've read this story, why didn't Jesus himself heal this lame man when he was on planet Earth? After all, the Bible says this man had been lame from his birth. And so that means the man had to have been around when Jesus was on planet Earth. Because remember now, Pentecost happened only 50 days after Jesus' resurrection. Acts 3 comes after Acts 2. So then Acts 2 is when Pentecost took place, 50 days after Jesus' ascension. And in Acts 3, we have this story, which means then the man had to have been alive when Jesus was on this earth. So why didn't Jesus heal the man himself? Well, Jesus is an on-time God. I believe somebody knows he may not come when you want him, but he's always right on time. Which means hope may not come when you want it, but hope is always on the way. And I just believe one of the reasons in my eisegesis, in my creative spiritual mind, that I believe Jesus didn't heal the man when Jesus was on this earth was because Jesus wanted to show the man and Jesus wanted to show us that there's power in the name of Jesus. Not just power in the person of Jesus, but there's power in the name of Jesus. Oh, somebody doesn't have it. You ought to be shouting right now. You see, in this miracle, it couldn't have been the person of Jesus. Jesus had died. Jesus had been buried. Jesus had risen from the grave. Jesus had ascended back to heaven. Jesus was not there physically when this lame man was healed, but healing, the Bible says, hallelujah, took place at the name of Jesus. Somebody's still not getting this. You see, back in the day, it was believed that the name of a person carried both the power and authority of the person. So then, if a king sent a messenger in his name, if the king sent a messenger in the name of the king, that messenger represented the same power and the same authority of the king. Which means then, when the name of Jesus is spoken, the same power and the same authority of Jesus is now in that person. The same power over heaven and earth is in that person. The same power over demons is in that person. So in the name of Jesus, I have power over demons. In the name of Jesus, I have power to tread over serpents. In the name of Jesus, I have power to tell sickness to flee. In the name of Jesus, I have power to tell cancer to go in remission. In the name of Jesus, I have power to rebuke bankruptcy and foreclosure. In the name of Jesus, all hell, the power of Jesus' name, let angels prostrate fall. There is no other name under heaven whereby we can be saved but the name of Jesus, because both power and authority are in the name of Jesus. Oh, but somebody's still not getting this. You're still looking at me crazy. Listen, before Peter told the man to rise up and walk in the name of Jesus, think about it. The man had everything he needed to walk. He had feet. The man had ankles. The man had legs. The man had hips. The man had knees. The man had tendons. The man had muscles. The man had bones. The man had everything he needed. He had all of the basic equipment that God gives to every human being, but the man couldn't walk. But when Peter told that man to rise up and walk in the name of Jesus, his feet got to moving. His ankles got to shifting. His knees got to bending, and his legs got to walking. Peter didn't lay hands on the man. Peter didn't anoint the man. Peter, he didn't put oil on the man. But at the name of Jesus, the man walked. Some of us are just like that lame man. Some of our lives are like that lame man. Some of our churches are like that lame man. Some of our ministries are like that lame man. What am I talking about? We have everything we need to live for Jesus. We have everything we need to grow God's work. We have pianos. We have organs. We have sound systems. We have pulpits. We have podiums. We have screens. We now in coronavirus have computers. We have the internet. We have live streams. We have preachers. We have teachers. We have praise teams. We have media teams. We have the intellect. We have the structure. We have the support. We have the skills. We have the talents. We have the gifts. We have the money. We have the resources. We have the buildings. We have the members. We have everything we need. But the reason some of our churches aren't growing, the reason some of our ministries aren't growing, is because we don't have the power. But in the name of Jesus, give us power. Power over our churches. Power over our ministries. Power over our schools. Power over our preaching. Power over our teaching. Power over our singing. In the name of Jesus, give us power. But somebody's still saying, okay, the lame man, the lame beggar received hope amidst his crisis. But somebody still wants to know, will we have hope in our crisis? Is hope still on the way? Because some of us live under the mistaken notion, like the lame man, that things will always be the same, that things will never get better. So our energy is defeated. Our ingenuity is devastated, all because we live with a mistaken notion that things will not change. But in the name of Jesus today, to my Jamaican brothers and sisters, in the name of Jesus, I want to let somebody know things can change. I want to let somebody know that things do not always and will not always remain the same. I want to let somebody know that hope, not just help, but I want to let somebody know that hope is on the way. Because if the Lord can do it for a lame man, then the Lord can do it for me. Because it is no secret what God can do. What he's done for others, he will do for you. I need to stop, and I'm really done with my sermon, but my soul's getting happy, and I want to make one more point. When Peter said, friends of mine, in the name of Jesus, it was the power and it was the authority that loosed the power of God into the lame man's life. The name of Jesus then was a trigger to release that power. Now, understand, a trigger activates a mechanism that discharges power from something. Because in order to get power from one place to another, you have to have an activation device. You didn't hear what I said. I said, in order to get power from one place to another, you have to have an activation device. You have to have a trigger. The trigger is the activation mechanism that precipitates a reaction. It sets up a chain reaction that initiates the power. When I'm driving my car and I place my foot upon my car accelerator in my car, it triggers the power in my car to drive faster. When I press my television remote control, it triggers the power to turn on my TV. When I flip the light switch on the wall, it triggers the power to turn the light bulb on in my room. And in the name of Jesus, the name of Jesus is the trigger that initiates the power of God in the direction of the name. It activates the loose weapons of heaven. Power moves at the sound of his name. Heaven comes to attention when the name of Jesus is spoken and dispatches power. Angels begin to move at God's command. Deliverance packs its bags and gets ready to move. Healing gets hurling in a hurry, and hope is encouraged because of the name of Jesus. There's power when you preach in the name of Jesus. There's power when you pray in the name of Jesus. There's power when you serve in the name of Jesus. There's power when you worship in the name of Jesus. There's power when you witness in the name of Jesus. There's power when you work in the name of Jesus. If God chooses, if it's God's express will, at his name, coronavirus can go away. At his name, cancer can go in remission. At his name, hurricanes can stop. At his name, economic inequity can cease. At his name, humans can be healed. At his name, relationships can be restored. At his name, jobs can be secured. If God chooses, at his name, it's gonna happen. But I like how Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego said. Those three Hebrew boys said, but if not, I'm still gonna praise his name, hallelujah. Because either now or at some time in the future, the day is coming where the name of Jesus, every knee shall bow, every tongue must confess that Jesus Christ is Lord. The day is coming where the wicked will cease from troubling and the weary will be at rest. The day is coming where it's going to get better, that there'll be no more crying, no more dying, no more sickness, no more pain, no more coronavirus, no more high blood pressure, no more diabetes, no more house note, no more car note, no more stress, no more mess in the name of Jesus. Satan can have his way, but for so long, hope is on the way. Jesus is coming back. Jesus has already defeated Satan. Our goal is not to fight victory from Satan. Our goal is to keep victory from not being robbed by Satan. Satan is already a defeated foe. Satan was done at the cross, and the same power that defeated Satan at the cross is the same power available to us to defeat Satan today. The moment you accept Jesus as your personal Savior, you take possession of what he did for you 2,000 years ago. So your identity as a child of God, your authority over spiritual powers are not things you are receiving or will receive, but they are things that you already have. Friends of mine, you better understand, we don't fight for Calvary, we fight from Calvary. We have power to defeat demons now. So we don't wait till the battle is over. We can shout now. The victory has already been won. Satan was defeated 2,000 years ago. His defeat is not pending. His defeat is not future. His defeat has already happened. Hallelujah. Hold on. Hope is on the way. I said, hold on. Hope is on the way. Jesus is coming. Crisis is here, but hold on. Hope is on the way. Calamity is here, but hold on. Hope is on the way. Destruction is here, but hold on. Hope is on the way. Jesus, the hope of glory, is on the way. So lift up the trumpet. Loud let it ring. Jesus is coming again. Cheer up, ye pilgrim. Be joyful and sing. Jesus is coming. Again, let me close this way. I'm a big sports fan, and I like watching sports on television. But you know, because I travel quite a bit, and because many sporting events take place when I'm not at home, I have to record those sporting games on my DVR, on my television, so I can watch them a little later. Now, when I'm traveling, I can't watch. But when I get home, I know I can watch because I've recorded them. And when I get home, and because I'm able to watch the games because I've reported them, I sit in my chair. I have a chair. My wife knows it's my chair. Our daughters know it's my chair. They don't sit. It's my chair. And I sit in my chair with my remote, and I watch my games. But when I watch the games, unlike most people, I don't start watching the games at the beginning of the game. But I fast forward to the end of the game to see who's won and to see who's lost the game. Now, if my team has lost, I'll stop watching. But if my team has won, I start watching from the beginning. Now, somebody may be saying, Pastor Bird, that's a strange way to watch the game. If your team has lost, you don't watch. But if your team has won, you watch from the beginning. That can't be funny, Pastor Bird, because you already know how the end is going to be. But you know what? I love it. Because no matter how bad things might look for my team, no matter how many points my team might be down during the game, I don't have to worry because I know the end of the story. And today, Camp Meeting Central Jamaica Conference, I just want to remind you that sometimes in this life, things may look bad. Things may look rough. Things may look tough. It may look like you're losing. In this life, it may look like you've lost. In this life, you may feel like giving up. In this life, you may feel that hope is lost. But the good news is, it doesn't matter how bad things look right now, we know how the end is going to be. Jesus is coming back. For the Lord himself shall descend from heaven with a shout, with the voice of the archangel, the trump of God, and the dead in Christ are going to rise first. Then we which are alive and remain shall be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air, and so shall we ever be with the Lord. He's coming back. Let not your heart be troubled. Ye believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you. I go and prepare a place for you, and if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you unto myself, that where I am, there ye be also. He's coming back. Blessed are they that do his commandments, that they may have a right to the tree of life and may enter in through the gates into the city. He's coming back, so meet me in the city. There are 12 gates to the city, 3 gates to the north, 3 gates to the south, 3 gates to the east, 3 gates to the west. The walls are made of jasper. The streets are made of gold. The wicked will cease from troubling. The weary will be at rest. Satan will be defeated. Death will be dead. Hallelujah! 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 We have hope amidst the crisis because hope is on the way. Christ returneth. Hallelujah. And hallelujah. Amen. Don't you ever think that hope is lost. Please don't throw in the towel. We know what the end is going to be. And because we know hope, Christ, the hope of glory is on the way. We can still have hope amidst the crisis. There's somebody right now, you want to give up. There's someone watching right now, if you're real, if you're honest, if you're transparent, you feel like throwing in the towel. If you're watching, there's somebody right now who feels it's not going to get better. But today I give you hope. I give you Jesus, the hope of glory. I know your children may be driving you crazy. I know your spouse may understand. I know your job is just giving you a hard time. I know your finances are in trouble, but hope is on the way. I know this coronavirus has you crippled. Cancer might have you crying. Diabetes might have you down, but hope is on the way. Today you want that hope. Today you need that hope. Today you even saying, I'm watching, I need baptism. Today you're watching, you're saying, I need to get that hope again. I've been baptized before, but I need to renew my commitment. I've maybe wandered from God, or maybe I've gotten weak in my Christian experience, but I need rebaptism. I need to re-solidify my faith, my hope in Jesus today. Whoever you are, wherever you are, I want to invite you to speak with your pastor. I want to invite you to go to the chat right now. I want to invite you, call the conference office, call Pastor Johnson, call any of our pastors, because this is the greatest decision you can make in your life, to acknowledge that you need hope, Christ, the hope of glory in your life. And amidst crisis, you can have hope. Today, this message was for you. Hold on. Hope is on the way, and we can have hope amidst the crisis. Father God, right now, I pray for the Central Jamaica Conference. its leaders, its pastors, its members, visitors, even those who are on the verge of membership, in the name of Jesus. Just like you could change circumstances for that lame man, I pray that we are reminded today that you can change our circumstances. Just like that man, that lame beggar, had hope and received hope, God, may we be reminded today that we too can receive hope. That we too have hope in Christ, the hope of glory. And God, may we be reminded today that it's not so much the person of Jesus, but it's at the name of Jesus, where, God, we can receive power and authority. And because of this power and authority, we can have hope. So seal the decision of that man, that woman, that boy, that girl has made a decision for baptism, that other individual who has made a decision for rebaptism, and then trouble the hearts, minds, bodies, souls, and spirits of those individuals who have yet to make their calling and election sure in Jesus. We love you, Lord, and we thank you. And we beg of forgiveness of sin. Give us hope amidst the crisis. It's in Jesus' name we pray today. Amen. To whoever's watching today, don't you ever forget, in what appears to be a hopeless situation, not just the person of Jesus, but at the name of Jesus, you can receive hope. Hope. Christ, the hope of glory. And if not on this side, as the three Hebrew boys say, but if not on this side, on the other side. Because the Bible is clear that the day is coming that at the name of Jesus, every knee shall bow and tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord. May God bless you, because we have this hope that burns within our hearts.